Thank you so much. It is an honor and a pleasure to be here with you, an honor to be with two old friends and the most distinguished, most accomplished journalist ever on television. Jim's a little shocked because I never really have a kind word for Jim. And
but it's still
the truth. So an honor and a pleasure, an honor to be with them, and a pleasure to be in a trio where I can be known as the kid. We're going to talk about the election first, and then talk about the lives and the works and the observation of these two distinguished gents. Susan said at the beginning that this was an unusual election. That is one way to put it. The other way is, what the? It's fair to say that Mr. Trump has made this an unusual election, but has his candidacy done any good, either for the system, for the nation, eventually for the campaign, the presence of so unusual a character?
Yes, I think so. It has, together with Bernie Sanders, it has given, I think, rather late, paid rather late national attention and brought to light the deep unhappiness of the American middle class, which feels it has suffered from all the things that we read about. And I think their unhappiness, if allowed to continue, is poisonous to the democracy, because the country was known and celebrated for a happy and contented and prosperous middle class, known around the world for that. And it is baked into, I think, into the American social contract that there won't be equality, but there will be a kind of egalitarianism which gives you opportunity. And if people see that disappearing, as I think they do, and is made evident in this campaign, then I think that's very important for the future.
Jim, do you think about Trump doing any good for the country or for the system? I mean, for the campaign itself, we know the destructive elements of it, but was there anything good to come out of it?
I agree with what Robin said, as I always have for all these years.
It's always just
Nothing's changed. No, I think he's absolutely right. But make sure that everybody understands, and I think Robin would agree, Trump did not invent this. He didn't discover it on his own. It was already there. What Trump did in his way was bring attention to it, and very little attention had been paid to it until Trump did that. That's it, as far as I'm concerned, in terms of the good that he has brought to the process. Because I think to look beyond that, there's a long list of things that he's brought to the process that any neutral observer, any even-handed journalist, or even uneven-handed journalist would, or any even-handed or even la 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 la, would have to look at the way he went about what he did has had a huge effect on the way people communicate and the world of journalism. Journalism has been affected probably permanently because of this.
Would you elaborate on that?
Well, there are three kinds of journalism, legitimate journalism. There's straight news journalism. That's the kind Robin and I always practiced for 112 years, collectively and individually. And then there's analytical journalism, and then there's opinion journalism. Each one is real and legit. But they were always carefully labeled, and they were always separate. And before Trump came, those lines had already begun to frazzle a little bit. And so you had Fox and you had MSNBC, two glaring examples that had become a little bit one side or the other politically. And in the old days, that was a no-no. Well, in current days, that is no longer the no-no. And what Trump has done now has taken it another step. When you cover a candidate for president of the United States, if for whatever reason you conclude as a journalist, now, a professional, somebody whose job it is to look and see and report back, observe, talk to others about it, and report back, makes comes to the negative conclusion that, say, one of the candidates, just to, as an example, just as to make up something, let's say it's a sociopath. Do you cover the sociopath candidate the same way you cover a non-sociopath candidate? With the same rules, the same wah-wahs, everything. I think that we're going to come out of this election, no matter the end result, saying, examining that thesis. My hope and prayer is that we don't get carried away with it, that we don't overdo it, that we don't decide, oh, well, he's a sociopath, so we can do anything. But at the same time, we figure out a way to separate the two in a professional way that is still even-handed and is still seen as neutral and is still seen as fair.
Has Trump been right, Robin, that the media is against him?
To a large extent, yes, but he's, whatever they're against, he's brought on himself. By violating or disregarding most of the norms that have been habitually thought of as appropriate for a presidential candidate in truthfulness or truthiness, or in his dismissal or denigration of certain groups and so on, he's carved out a new empire that has got a lot of people very very upset. Because if you follow what Jim's been saying, which I always do,
No, it's the other way around.
He's put journalism in a real perplexity. Do I cover this guy straightforwardly and seriously? I mean, well, one of the criticisms of the media, and I'm still old-fashioned enough, I think it's a plural noun, not a singular, because how can it be it when it's all these different things? Television in particular gave Trump extraordinary time beyond its straight journalism coverage because he was so entertaining, and they got good ratings for it. And Les Moonves, the head of CBS, said, well, it may not be good for the country, but it's good for CBS. And he got extraordinary coverage of his rallies, and which were very entertaining. So, and he knew how to use that because of his experience on television and so on. So it's thrust the media, all of them, into areas of perplexity they were never in before. And led us all to examine ourselves. I thank God we weren't still in the business having to deal with it.
I say that little prayer every day. But you know, Roger, I think, and I may be wrong about this, I mean, people may disagree, this is my, make it very quickly, I will make my theory very quickly about what happened here with the press and Trump, got us where we are today, is that at the very beginning, Trump was considered to be a joke. The birther thing was, my God, how can anybody who didn't believe that President Obama was born in America, I mean, this guy's running for president? Oh, give me a break. And the first thing he did is he walks down the escalator at Trump Tower and talks about the wall he's going to build, and then the next thing he does is he attacks. So the conventional wisdom among the professionals, mainline journalism professionals, was this guy's toast, forget it, don't worry about it, it's just a matter of days. And then he kept doing things that were a little more outrageous and just a little bit, and all we did, I mean, say the big we, both Robin and I were both sitting on the porch by then.
Trained observers.
Yeah. We were trained observers of the trained observers.
Right.
At any rate, to make a long story not quite as long, we just kept reporting what he was doing, and that alone, just reporting it straight. And then everybody said, well, this guy's nuts, and he's going to be out here. Well, boom, they started with 17 candidates, and boom, my God, suddenly he's leading in the polls. And then they had to start treating him seriously. And, oh, my God, what was Trump University about? Oh my God, what was his relationship with women? All those stories that should have been done earlier, but were not done because nobody took him seriously as a candidate. By the time they got to it, for instance, let's say just to make my point, and I am going to make my point now, okay? Let's say that we had known about all his relationship with women and his attitude toward women and the groping and seen the tape. The tape was done in 2005. Right. When did it come out? 3 or 4 weeks ago. What if it had come out at the beginning of the campaign of Donald Trump, or maybe even halfway through it? All that, let's say that all of that digging had been done then, he might not have been the Republican nominee, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. End of point.
Let me, Rachel Maddow did something very effective the other night. I don't know if you saw it. She created a fable and had cartoonish illustrations for it. The fable was based on the idea that in election season, we are a family, and we have our family reunion at this point. And a family reunion has all sorts of odd people coming to the family, people you recognize and people you don't, people you haven't seen in years, and so forth. So the analogy of the fable was really quite good. Then she says, a cousin shows up that nobody has ever seen, but it still claims to be a cousin of the family. And first he's rude, and then he's lewd and makes advances towards the women in the family. And then he gets more and more dangerous and more and more dangerous and more and more dangerous to a point that he threatens the very existence of the family. And what she was doing was pinning that analogy on Trump saying that he would not accept the results
of the election.
I think Rachel was concluding was we have not only somebody not to laugh at, but a very dangerous character. Do you think he's a dangerous character?
If he became president, I'm not a commentator, so I'm not commenting, but many people have said that he would be a danger to the democracy. I mean, the fact that he's cozying up to Putin, the current New Yorker has him being sworn in as president by the Chief Justice, and the significant other for him holding the Bible is Putin. Bill Clinton holds it for Hillary on the same page. But his demonstrated ignorance of many of the issues that put this country on edge or on peril in the world, Putin, for example, in Crimea and the Ukraine, and his oversimplification of many issues, and his casual reference to the use of nuclear weapons. I covered Barry Goldwater for most of the year 63 and 64, and we were at the New Hampshire primary, and Goldwater casually mentioned at this press conference that he thought, maybe NATO field commanders should have the use of tactical nuclear weapons. Everybody ran for the phones, and it dogged Goldwater for the rest of the year and gave rise to the Daisy Petal commercial.
Absolutely.
That was shown only once but became notorious. So for all kinds of reasons that various experts in this area are not, and I'm not, including the economy, believe that he would be a danger.
Jim?
I'm not a commentator either, but if I were a commentator, here's what I'd say.
I'm not a radish either, but if I were a radish, get on with it.
I think.
We're not pundits.
We're not pundits either. We're not commentators, we're not pundits.
Good.
But if we were pundits or commentators,
yes.
That's what I would say. Yeah, right. No, the seriously, I think that a lot of this is about whether or not he has in fact been a damaging force right. In any kind of lasting way. Is going to be resolved on election day. In other words, if he is thrashed, I mean, let's put it this way: if he loses by 10 or more points, and say 400 or more electoral college votes, my guess is that his ability to continue to be a force will be reduced dramatically. And maybe he may be reduced into basic harmlessness. If by chance that's not the case, and he's still got some life, and he's still got some people that will listen to him and pay attention to him. And the press is going to have to make a decision there too. What are they going to do after this guy is he loses? Let's assume let's assume for discussion purposes he loses. Okay. American journalism isn't going to decide, well, do we still quote this guy every time he does something and he walks out and boom, boom, booms? I don't know.
I think it's important what happens to all the people who supported Trump after, supposing
yes.
he loses,
yeah.
as the current polls seem to suggest he will. Although I have a little reserve skepticism and probably paranoid that there are hundreds of thousands of Trump voters who haven't signed up to any poll or admitted it to any poll and are going to burst out on election day like the Brexit voters in England to whom they've been compared. I think it's very important that the media and the political system and the so-called elites pay attention to all the people for whom Trump has been a megaphone and a voice, because their unhappiness with their situation, which is real, some commentators have called it shame, others anger, but whatever it is a huge force in this country, and as I said earlier, vital to the stability harmoniousness of the democracy, that they find some answer for their.
I agree,
absolutely.
Robin. But at the same time, that is not an excuse for the racism and.
No, I'm not suggesting that.
And all of that. Yeah.
But it's certainly not. And that I want to get to too in the question of the haters that he has caused to arise.
Exploited.
But holding just on the idea of the working man who feels out of it. Which is so often the Trump voter. The other day, I pulled a Jim Lehrer. I want to tell you what that means. That means you start a fist fight with somebody. You're old and you're out of shape, and you start a fist fight with somebody. When Jim was recovering from an operation, his wife Kate said, "Would you come over and take him for a walk?" A lot of people think that that means just accompanying somebody, but actually I almost had a leash, and it was good because we were walking in Cleveland Park, and a guy goes 5 or 6 feet beyond the stop sign level, and Jim, just recovered from an operation, goes lunging after this guy to kill him. So luckily I had the leash and was able to draw him back. I could tell you other stories, but the time is short.
Mild displeasure.
Yes,
that's all I did.
Yeah, I know. So I pulled him Lehrer the other day in a pizzeria. The guy behind the counter was looking admiringly at Trump on TV. I say, "You like this guy?" And I deliberately provoked an argument with him. Always a good idea to pick a fight with a guy who's twice your size, half your age. But I had him in mind. Nonetheless, I got out of there without my head being handed to me. And though obviously I was better at it and could argue it and things and said, "You want him to be near your daughter," and all the predictable things, he said at the end of this, "I'm an outsider. And he is for the outsiders. He's an outsider." And I walked away from that thing thinking, wasn't there a time when the Democrats appealed to the outsiders?
Sure.
Of course.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
But what happened in the interim to have this man feel so alienated from any system that Trump looked good?
Well, Bernie Sanders, who's an outsider too, and is by choice in his political position, spoke for the same unhappy and discontented and I think understandably unhappy with their situation, whether it's through technology or globalization or immigration or simply the inevitable forces of the economy, whatever it is. They are unhappy, and their unhappiness needs to be solved in some way or other. There's a political economist at Harvard, Benjamin Friedman, who wrote the other day that no solution that Hillary or Trump has proposed is going to solve any of the real, or resist any of the underlying forces that are causing the predicament that the middle class is in, that it will take, and of course, with the political deadlock there is in this country and the tax phobia there is, it's unlikely that anything really radical is going to come forth out of this election. Nothing like when capitalism was seen to be under threat in the 1930s produced the radical legislation of the New Deal. It doesn't look as though the system can produce anything, at least in the eyes of this professor, anything large enough to deal with this problem.
But at least Hillary Clinton, I'm not advocating one way or another about Hillary Clinton, but Hillary Clinton, what Hillary Clinton has promised to do is to go at the middle directly. In other words, not trickle it down, as some people would, or start necessarily from the top, but go directly toward the middle class, infrastructure and other stuff.
And she'll be a domestic policy president.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But let me ask you this. Why is it then, what is it about Hillary Clinton that bothers people?
She's a woman.
Is that it? I mean, that's certainly one theory, that's it.
She's a woman in a country that seems to dislike seeing women being competitive and aggressive.
I agree. It's 90% of
it. And it's been pointed out that when Hillary actually achieves a position like election to the Senate, people like her a lot more.
That's right.
It's in the struggle to get there that she has all the negatives.
How dare her want to be a Wawa, fill in the blank.
Well, there's that. And then there's also what she herself has called a long-term right-wing conspiracy to accuse her of this and that scandal. And she's, how many hours has she spent testifying to congressional committees about one investigation after another?
You know, it's not original with me, because many of the, quote, commentariat have said this, that if you go through all the things that are held against her, you know, by people who really don't like Hillary Clinton, and she did this, she did this, she did this, she did this, you go on with the list, and then you say, okay, you go back through and name a man similar who did this and this and this and that with not the same negative effect. And to me, that tells you what I just said, that her number one obstacle has always been the fact that she's a woman. And she gets over it this time with the help of Donald Trump. Let's face it.
Yeah, that's true.
Seriously.
Yeah.
She may be over it, and it may be a bigger thing than any of us can even think about, because there's been so much other stuff to think about. The election of Hillary Clinton, the first woman as president of the United States, could be something that says things for generations to come. And it will have happened here. And it might not have happened if we hadn't had a candidate as flawed as, what's his name?
But as dogged a fighter, is she?
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, that's right.
Absolutely right.
Talk about the debates a bit. You ran 12 of these debates. You're on the debate commission.
Yes.
Now we've had three here. The second one was the Donnybrook, the second debate. It had happened just after the revelations of Trump coming off the bus and making the comments on the bus and so forth. When you have a wild situation like that, how does a moderator handle the debate? How does he tame it, or does he try to control it? Does he just let it go?
Well, there are no rules here. Roger, I learned the hard way that a debate, any given debate, takes on a life of its own. And within the first few minutes, you can control it at the beginning. The moderator can, by just the questions he or she asks, and you can set the tone, hopefully, but they can take the tone away and Billy Bob candidate and Sammy Sue candidate can start doing just the opposite of what you want them to do. They can decide not to, to abide by the rules. In other words, just talk a little bit longer than they're supposed to. Or you could ask them about apples and they talk about oranges.
Or that interrupting all the time that Trump is doing.
Exactly. And there are a lot of things that are out of the control of the moderator. And control is everything. But the irony, I don't know if irony is the word, but that's a word, that's the kind of word that MacNeil uses a lot, but I don't know.
Roger said it was dead. Irony.
That's true.
At the same time you want, the moderator wants control, you also want the candidates to mix it up. So
right.
those moments when there is no control, when they're actually looking at each other. I mean, at one debate when I did between Obama and the first time we were supposed to really open it up was Obama and McCain. And I said at the very beginning of the thing, well, and the rules have been changed and, you know, modified or whatever. And both McCain and Obama knew exactly what the deal was. And I would ask, Obama would say something and I'd turn to McCain. McCain would give an answer to Obama and he'd always look right at me. And then I first couple of times I said, well, you say that directly to the president. Or no, well, he wasn't president then. Senator Obama. And so I did that a couple of times and he wouldn't do it. Mm. McCain would not look at Obama. And finally, McCain said to everybody, so all millions of people, you know, all my family and former Sunday school teachers and everybody could hear, what's the matter, Jim? You can't hear? So I decided maybe there won't be any back and forth like that. But the difficult thing that Chris Wallace, for instance, had in the sixth debate, in the 2016, the last debate, where he set a tone at the beginning, which I fully endorse as a member of the commission, and is that there was an awful lot of stuff in the way, personal stuff, in the wind, but he started with issues, and he said to the American people, this is what is really what a debate should be. It was way down in there before he got, you know, to the bus tape and all the ramifications of that. And so you can do things like that, but there are limits to what a moderator can do.
It's in the NewsHour, there were occasional wild moments, and I used to get a kick out of watching Robin handle a maniac. No matter who it was, there'd be somebody shouting and saying, I will kill him, I will destroy him, I will destroy his children, his children's children. And Robin would listen in that civilized way and with that wonderful voice say, I see. I want to get off the election to talk about the wonderful lives and the careers of both of you. We were talking about two interesting public figures. Who are among the more interesting people you talked to during your lives and interviewed? Is it harder to interview a hero than a scoundrel?
I learned something from him. He was a young reporter on the Dallas, I forget, was it the Times Herald?
Times Herald, yeah.
And they sent you out to the airport to interview a cardinal or something. And just, why am I going out? And anyway, he went out to the airport and said, what's it like being a cardinal? Out it all came. I learned a lot of interviewing from him because he wasn't afraid to say, I don't understand, or can you explain that?
Well, what he said to me, he said, one time, this was a compliment, and I took it as one, okay? All right. He said, oh, Jim, I've learned so much from you. You've taught me how to ask dumb questions. That's what he's trying to say.
That's not true. He makes stuff up. That's not true.
Well, that's another story.
But most of the anecdotes about me, he's made up.
One day, he made the mistake of saying to me, we were doing some, we'd been doing a lot of talking about stuff and back and forth and whatever. And he said, oh, well, just, you know, whatever, you know, you and I agree on stuff, just whatever you want to say, that's fine. So, and it's okay, you know, so I fell into this habit, not a good habit, of somebody asked me a question that I really didn't want to answer. At an event like this, let's say somebody would say, "Well, who's the neatest person you ever interviewed?" Say somebody like that, and I didn't want
to
answer
that.
I didn't want to answer that question. I would say, "Well, Robert MacNeil always said his favorite person to answer was." And finally, Robin just went on and on for a while, and Robin finally said to me, "Jim, somebody said it. You said it for a group of people in Sioux City, Iowa, that I was in favor of, you know, whatever it is." And I said, "Oh gosh, Robin, I forgot to tell you. I had told you that I told somebody you'd said this, but I really got bad about it." But what it was a wonderful thing for me was because if I didn't want to say something, I could put it on him.
He also refers to me as the former Robert MacNeil. And I remember that when people on the street occasionally stop me and say, "How does it feel to be retired, Mr. Lehrer?"
Robert, would you tell us all how the NewsHour came to be?
Well, first of all, Jim and I found ourselves partners in Washington in 1973 for a few months doing a weekly program called America 73. And then the Senate Watergate hearings were announced and public television decided to cover them, not only all day long without interruptions, but to repeat that at night. And he and I jointly anchored them for 47 days and nights. Wow. And many people in public television had thought we should be doing sophisticated entertainment and education and culture and not journalism, not public affairs, because that would cause controversy and everything. But our coverage of the Senate Watergate hearings, which clearly were a turning point in this country in all kinds of ways, got more and more people suddenly watching their public television stations and sending money to them. That turned people's heads around in public television, and people began saying, "Well, you've become a team, you should do a daily show." And so we said yes, if there was the money and the stations wanted it. It took 2 years to bring it together, for one reason, because our immediate bosses in Washington said, "Well, you can't be on the air and run the program." And we said, "Why not?" And anyway.
You said, thank yeah, God. You said.
And after some discussions of this, incidentally, we'd come under a lot of attacks from the Nixon White House just for doing journalism on public television. Mm. I mean, at that time, I was anchoring Washington Week in Review, as it was known then. And Nixon's appointee as the head of CPB said that program shouldn't be on the air, you know. Anyway, we finally got it together in the fall of 1975 when the New York station said, we're under Jay Islin and Bob Kotlowitz, both late friends, said, "You can do it any way you like here." And we got it together. At first, your bosses said, "Well, you can't be on every night."
That's right.
And
that's right.
It began with my name on it, and for
terrible six, title. Tell them what the title of the show was.
The title was The Robert MacNeil Report. A brilliant title.
Terrible title.
No, actually, it came about because Angela Solomon, who was the public relations and press representative for Channel 13, came up after I'd been there a couple of months and said, "What are you going to call the program?" And I said, "Well, I've been making a list. Well, News Night, News Watch, News Forum, all the really ripping titles." Anyway, she said, "I thought we'd hired somebody smart." And I said, "What do you mean?" And she said, "Why not use your own name?" And I said, this is how naive a Canadian I was then, new to New York, "Well, what do you mean? What if a year from now Jay Islin wanted somebody else to do the job?" And she said, "Dummy." Anyway, finally, Jay Islin offered the program to PBS. They ran it free. The stations liked it. More and more stations liked it. And within 6 months, it became the MacNeil-Lehrer Report.
But it also changed. It changed television journalism. It started to teach everybody how to think about the news. It wasn't just a rehearsal of what had happened during the day.
We tried to be different. And it was easier to be different then, because most cities had only three or four stations, including one educational. And it was quite easy to be different. And also, we were put on in the half hour after NBC and CBS Nightly News. In fact, we even took out one daring ad, watch Walter Cronkite, then watch us, you know.
That's right.
And so, and because we decided talking heads can be interesting, which the commercial industry despised at that time, we can make it interesting. And so we worked to do that. And we were different in that sense. And we did one subject for half an hour for 7 years.
You had, I remember, and I quote you here accurately, one of the most marvelous things you ever said was the whole talking, people were putting us down because we were talking heads. And you said, and I cannot quote you accurately, but you said very emotionally and firmly, look, where was it when you first heard that somebody you loved was ill, that somebody you knew and cared about had lost their lives, that you had just given birth to a child? It was a talking head that told you that. All the important things of life that you've been told, you heard from a talking head. That's the business we're in.
Yeah.
And that shut him up.
Well, the other, my other.
You also, the other one was, somebody wrote in the first time we ever had anything nice written about us was the man named Tom. He was the media critic for, it wasn't called media critic then, it was called journalism critic at Time Magazine. He wrote a piece and he said that MacNeil and Lehrer had the courage to be serious. And the thing we added to it was we also had the courage to be boring if it's necessary from time to time.
My mantra, which Jim has heard me say 1,000 times, in public television, if you can't be better than commercial television or different from, you shouldn't be begging money from the public. And whether you're better or not is always a question with all sorts of ramifications. But whether you're different from is easier to identify. And our successor program, the PBS NewsHour, is still different from commercial television. And of course, all public television is different to the extent that it doesn't have commercial interruptions every seven minutes. But different from is important. And I think if public television ever loses that, and ever wants, because there are people in public television who want to become more like the real world of television as they see it, commercial television, and where the greater rewards are, and they would like to be more like that. Well, if public television ends going that way, it will disappear.
The other thing you said from the very beginning, which has been the hallmark of this program when it started and it still is you said, we're in the business of civil discourse.
Yeah, yeah.
And civil discourse is a term that is terribly relevant right now. But you said that at the very beginning. You said that to everybody. You said that to me. That's what we're doing.
Did either of you have a favorite moment on the NewsHour other than the essay portion of the show? Which, by the way, Mike Saltz is in the audience, and my genius friend was the one who created this, so I take no credit. I give it all to Mike. But a favorite moment, either in terms of an interview or a news item that you had to suddenly rise to?
Well, when we were in a half hour mode, doing a whole program for a whole subject for in half an hour, we had all kinds of disasters. We did a half hour on the Ogallala Aquifer, which was a huge underground water supply in the High Plains states that was being depleted at the rate of a foot a year and replenishing itself naturally about an inch a year. We had four guests lined up who knew all about this, two in Washington with him, two with me. I interviewed the first guy and said, when is this going to become really serious? And he said, about 2030. Oh yeah, the second or third night we did Spain after Franco. Franco inconsiderately didn't die for another year and a half.
In the early days, we'd been on the air maybe for 2 or 3 months, and Robin came down with something. You had an operation, hernia operation, something like that, some kind of harmless operation.
Let's not get too intimate.
Yeah.
At any rate, I had to fill in, and we'd already scheduled the programs, and lo and behold, we were confronted with having to do 30 minutes on some elections in Portugal. And I said to the then executive producer, why the hell are we doing this program on Portugal? I forgot. But remember, Robin had a house there in Portugal. And he really cares about Portuguese elections. And I said, well, that's really great, but Robin happens to be in a hospital in New York. And, whatever. At any rate, for me, I started, we had 4 guests, one subject a night. So that meant 30 minutes on these elections in Portugal. And I'm about 12 minutes in. I've interviewed all 4 of these people. 12 minutes in, and I'm thinking, we have now told the American people more than they're ever going to want to know about the Portuguese elections. And I'm thinking, I've still got, 16 minutes at least still to go, 18 minutes still to go. Anyhow, I go in, get up to about 20 minutes, and I think, oh my God, now we've told even the Portuguese people more than they ever And I still had 10 minutes to fill. And to this day, I always was going to go back and first of all, bury the tape if I could find it after I looked at it. But I gave you so much hell after that. I said, you get your out of bed and get back in there. We're going to quit doing these things.
Can I tell a story about the first live television interview I did? I remember to this day. It was 1954 in Ottawa, Canada. And I was finishing my mediocre BA and working for the CBC on the radio. And they opened the first television station and they decided to cover with a mobile unit the Ottawa Valley Exhibition, which is kind of like a state fair in the States. And I was there on a live feed with a lollipop mic saying, good evening, for the first time, the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation is going to provide television coverage of the Ottawa Valley Exhibition. Before we cede to the lights of this year's X, we're very fortunate to have the man who, for the last 27 years, has led this important cultural event. Mr. I'm terribly sorry, I've forgotten your name. This is live. He told me his name, and then I suddenly remembered, I've got to turn for political reasons and interview the guy on the other side. I kept stretching out the first interview, trying desperately to remember the other guy's name. Finally, I had to turn to the camera and say, we're also fortunate to have number 2 man. You're not going to believe this, sir. I've forgotten your name, too.
Equal time. Perfect.
It's training like that that has made Canadian broadcasting so welcome in the United States.
I tell you, there were times that there was an unspoken rule, probably the spoken rule, that there was no joking and no laughter on the NewsHour. Therefore, when something funny happened on the NewsHour, it was twice as funny as it would be in the ordinary world. And I think you fellows may remember, Charlene Hunter-Galt was doing an interview on the always riveting subject of education. And there was a woman from Wisconsin with a German name. And so she said, and good evening, Miss Wagenschwager. And she said, that's Wagenschwager. Charlene dutifully said, Fugenschwager. The woman said, that's Hasenpfeffer. The camera started to tremble because the whole issue of the interview became the pronunciation of this woman's name. Great moments in sports. We are coming to a point where we're going to ask questions, and there was one question I wanted to ask these two really remarkable men who brought the highest intelligence and integrity and honesty and plain decency to TV journalism. Was this worth a life? Both of you could have been writers. You could have done something else. You could have been an actor.
All those things spun out in front of you. You invented a show, very rare. You stayed with it all this time, polished it, leave it to others to continue so you create a legacy. If you've ever thought about your lives, are you pleased with the choices that you made?
Amen, 100%. I can't imagine having a better life than I've had. I'm having,
thank you.
I'd say. Mine is blessed with the professional life as well as the personal life. The professional life is simply that I can honestly say that there are few people who have made news in the last 40 years that I haven't had some kind of contact with.
Right.
I've interviewed every kind of person. There are no kind of cliches left for me. In other words, somebody says, oh, well, he's just a left-handed person from Wawa. I interviewed one of them. Oh, well, she was in the... I interviewed one of them. And the process, because of the nature of our program, to interview somebody on our program requires more than knowing their name. Because clearly it does. But I mean, you had to really kind of get into it. And it was part of the job. And to have the luxury of being forced to know a little bit more than others did about things that matter.
Very good.
Was a great experience for me, and to meet all kinds of different people, and to work with people who shared this the MacNeil. I mean, yes, I'm not falsely modest here, but it was basically Robin's vision that started this whole thing, but there were many of us who followed that and lived with it and enjoyed it and prospered intellectually and otherwise with it. And there's nothing worse for me to be around somebody who's fortunate and either doesn't know it or won't admit it.
Nice.
I am not one of those people.
Very good.
nor am I. And I fell into journalism because I wasn't any good or wasn't going to succeed in the things I wanted to do, which is, first of all, really dumb to be an actor. And I fortunately had an epiphany that told me I'd be a lousy actor, and I quit that. Then I wanted to be a playwright, and the plays didn't sell, and one thing led to another, and I became a journalist. But I've had a magnificently... life has been extremely generous to me in this way. And having a friend and colleague like him, where I never had to worry that somebody was going to be competitive in terms of threaten my career, quite the contrary. And television is a very competitive business. And so having a friend and colleague like Jim has been a reward in itself.
Amen, 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 yeah. For me.
We are going to turn to the questions now from the audience, and I ought to tell you that questions from the 92nd Street Y audience are different from other questions. When I gave a reading here a number of years ago, I finished what I thought was a moving reading about one of my masterworks, and I looked for questions, and there were no questions, and then someone raised his hand and said, are you related to Yosela Rosenblatt? The great Ukrainian cantor. I did not know if I was related to Yosela Rosenblatt, the great Ukrainian cantor, and I said so, and then I looked around the audience praying that there would be another question. No. First guy says, what a voice. I look around then, praying again, somebody, please ask me about my work. Nobody. He raises his hands again. He says, you don't look a thing like him. So,
This is interesting. Does Hillary have a chance of uniting the country after all this? We assume that Hillary wins. We talked about what would happen to Trump if he lost, big or small. What does Hillary have to do to unite the country?
I think that she has a marvelous opportunity to unite the country. However, it will be increasingly difficult based on the margin of victory. In other words, if she wins by a huge amount, and let's say the Senate goes Democratic, and the House either goes Democratic or is just marginally Republican, she has the ability to do what she says she wants to do, and she can do it in a way that she will have the time and the energy and the willingness to explain it as she's doing it and bring people on board. I think the opportunity is there for her to bring the country together. But if one of those things, for instance, if she wins by a small margin and the Democrats don't gain control of the Senate or the House, we could have a rough patch, and the country will defiantly not go with her. I hate to say it this grossly, but end result has to be, in one way at least, and I hadn't thought of it to this very moment, so I probably shouldn't say it, but I'm going to, because if I don't, never mind. I think the end result has to be such that neither she nor the country has any choice but to get together. In other words, all the excuses are gone. Hillary doesn't have to do this because she won by a set. You know, in other words, she's off the hook, and the people who didn't vote for her are off the hook, and because there were still a huge bunch of them, and Trumpism has still got some life to it and whatever, and the right wing is this and the left wing is that, and there's still some Bernie Sanders people that don't want to go along. You know, all the fracturing of the American public, if it remains fractured, ain't going to happen.
I'd agree. The size of if she wins, her victory is very important. Also important is the attitude of what used to be called the loyal opposition. I mean, the opposition to Obama set out to obstruct.
That's right.
And did.
He proposed. If that continues and she doesn't win the Senate or is on the margin and doesn't improve the Democratic position in the House, then the chances of her getting any legislation through are difficult. If the mindset, which Mitch McConnell famously said after Obama's re-election, the main, the most important thing in his job was to prevent Obama having a second term. Sorry, I've got the timing wrong. Was to prevent, and he did everything, I think, evidently, notoriously, to do what he could to prevent that. He didn't prevent it, but as an example, the Senate has refused to move, under his leadership, to move on Obama's Supreme Court.
Right, exactly.
For 9 months now, outrageous. I think it is.
Yeah. And it goes beyond just legislation. If you have a strong president with all kinds of power, the people in Upper Ukahakawakistan are going to pay a little more attention than they would be even somebody named Putin might even see things differently. Everything, the whole, it will affect, not just, it'll affect everything. And can be hopeful.
This is the flip side of this. We started to talk about this before, not quite to the extent of this question. Will Trump take his candidacy to the nth degree and cause a rebellion, an insurrection? The question implies that Trump would deny the validity of the vote and therefore get whatever number of people it is. It's still frightening how many people he attracts. Get whatever number of people they are and just go off.
He himself has said it depends on the margin, on how big.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'll be living in Tuscany if that happens, but it won't matter.
I'm going back to Nova Scotia.
I think it's unlikely that that's going to. I agree with Robin that the margin will probably. I don't know if exactly what you. I think the margin will dictate that, and I think a lot of those ifs are not going to be practical.
And such of the loyal opposition, so much of it was determined to demonstrate the illegitimacy of Obama's presidency.
I know. Right. And,
we'll see.
What structural changes would you like to see to improve American elections, and how would we achieve them, assuming that you would like to see structural changes?
You mean the I don't
in the general
I like it to be messy. I like our system. I don't want it too neat and tidy.
That now.
Yeah. As long as everybody's treated fairly, as long as people, more importantly, are perceived as having been treated fairly, then I kind of like it all kind of, as I say, messy. Bottom line is I haven't studied the electoral process to where I don't have a list of things, a reform list. That's not my thing.
There's one move or gesture that I approve of, whether it'll go anywhere or not, would be to depoliticize, if possible, the state-by-state control of redistricting.
Good idea.
Will flow to some extent from how large a vote the two parties get down the ballot in this election, so many in the 8 years of Obama, so many governorships and state legislatures have been captured by the Republicans, and that has led to redistricting struggles, which are controversial and in the courts and everything else. But it's so that very few House seats are now really competitive in this election.
So either Democrat or Republican.
Yeah, because they've been gerrymandered to ensure a result.
It's a different sort of question, and it's one of these questions that's about something that's in our face every day. Do you feel that the social media has played a positive or a negative role in this election? This may be the first election where social media has had any play at all. Twitters and tweets and all that.
Well, I think the risk to conventional journalism, square journalism as we grew up with, is immense, that I see the social media as kind of devouring journalism. Either they're retailing stuff that serious journalists have collected, but what they really want is stuff that has more clickbaits in it, that cause more people to click on Twitter or whatever, the Facebook or so on. And even the New York Times now, I know from talking to one of their star reporters, in reviewing editorial stuff the next day, they talk about the number of tweets or clicks or whatever that certain stories got on the social media. And to survive, the serious newspapers like the Times and the Washington Post and so on are relegating more and more of their resources to appealing to people online with video and so on. I don't know, I think the whole, and now AT&T wants to buy Time Warner and so on. I've never lived in a time of such extraordinary confusion unanswerable questions about where all the media are going.
There's you could call it a revolution, you could call it a tsunami, whatever. We are in the middle of something that we don't really understand and haven't got a hold of yet. Social media is the ultimate kind of double-edged sword and a huger double-edged sword, which is this revolution about everybody knows everything about everything and nothing, you know. Everything is available, but it's not accessible. Everything is available, but it's not always believable. And the flow of stuff, you know, through social media, through the various things that are now available, online are incredible, and some of it's fabulous. I mean, it is terrific, and that's one side of the sword. The other side of the sword is the social media is a perfect example. It's terrific. People are communicating in ways they've never communicated before. We share all kinds of information that we've never shared before. Yeah, we share it with everybody in the world. I mean, because everything can be hacked and is being hacked. Anybody who writes anything in an email today is an idiot. You know, if he or she thinks it's going to be private. There is no more. Privacy's gone, done, over, forever. The whole world of journalism is in a state of revolution, and people are getting hurt. Their jobs are being hurt. People are getting information that's faulty. People are not getting information they should have before they cast votes, and all this. In other words, everything is very much in flux at the moment. And you just looked at your watch, which is a sign that I should shut up.
Yeah. Well, it's a sign that we all should. For 22 years, I had the uncommon privilege of working, I was going to say in the shadow, but it was really in the light of these two gents who changed everything in television and therefore not only took the news seriously, but took America seriously and taught us in some way to be both serious and civilized. The country owes you a great deal.
Oh, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.